rock and roll music, you know. It was the single thing that was able to reach down, communicate, and give you a sense of the world outside.
It's not even recognizable as the same thing that people called this rock and roll that won't survive.
Mystery and mischief are the two most important ingredients in rock and roll.
This great music that we've discovered, this great music which is still growing, this music which now you can write songs about what's really happening deep, deep, deep inside of you and what's happening around you in the world, can also sound extraordinary. You know, there's no reason why it shouldn't sound as good as Mozart or Beethoven or you know, a great Ellington gig.
People let bands change them, you know, in their lifestyle. You know, there's people who listen to music as ritually, you know, oh God, I need to listen to Metallica when I wake up, it's my coffee or something like that. Or there's people that kind of just flip on the radio and just as they go to work.
Rock and roll is fun. It's full of energy, it's full of laughter, it's naughty.
Come on, I'll suck it to the one time. You move me, look out.
Music is like sex, and you spend more time talking about it than you actually do doing it.
Jazz was for the brain, and blues and rhythm and blues and rock and roll was from the groin, from the belly.
Between wanting to make money and wanting to meet women is why we got into rock and roll in the first place. I mean, we loved music, we wanted to express ourselves, but anyone that tells you they didn't get into rock and roll to get laid is lying.
In the 90s, we've had time to look and inspect and analyze everything and be influenced by everything. There's not a whole lot of pioneering going on right this minute. The pioneering went on earlier.
You know the landlord rang my front door bell. I let it ring for a long, long spell. I went through the window, I peeped through the blind, and I asked him to tell me what was on his mind.
There's nothing but rhythm and blues. That R&B stands for real black.
Rock and roll is rock and roll. And you're not going to beat rock and roll music. If you do, I want to hear it.
Juvenile delinquents played rock and roll in the 50s, wore leather jackets. In the 60s, hippies played it. In the 70s, there was juvenile delinquents, but that was an old word, so they used punk. And they cleaned it up with new wave and put a tie on. But it's all about music and songs, you know, and what songs are popular to people at the time.
You roll with it, you rock with it, you move it, you feel it, and you believe in it.
Rock and roll is a commitment. Rock and roll is passion and spirit.
Yeah! If I define rock and roll, it would be freedom and rebellion.
It's what it's all about. It's performing that which you feel strongly about to other people, because the songs just come alive then. That's when they live and breathe.
And rock and roll is something that's hardcore and rough and wild and sweaty and wet and just loose.
I think there needs to be a certain amount of outlaw to rock and roll. You know, and at that time, we were at that age where we really were those outlaws. We were, if we were in the old West, we would have been bank robbers, I'm sure. You know? But luckily there was music around, so we ended up being musicians.
Rock music is high-velocity folk music. It is our life and times, you know, but with fury and some passion.
Such a strong medium that it's almost too good. It's forced to keep itself alive in any way, shape, or form, and it does that through its agelessness, its capabilities of being so euphoric that it can get anybody stoned and caught in, brought into its web.
To tell you the truth, that's what I think drives the greatest music, is simplicity and truth.
It's a threat, really. I think that's really the key of it.
Most kids hate their parents, artists, their big sisters and brothers, artists. You know, they don't necessarily, they want to get away from that more than anything.
Being one of this is only 5% of the beers I'm at Rose. That's the way it goes when you think I rank. I never drink point blank or old loans. Suckers got me running from the bank. Civil liberty, I can't see the pay of fee. I never saw a way to pay a salary to law. Then become the victim of a lawyer. And though you never saw it, take cues. Get me sued playing games with my head. What the judge said, put me in the red. Got me thinking about a ticket to the land. No, no, my
education. It's supposed to shake you out of your establishment place and say, like, well, gee, I really don't understand that. Exactly. That's the point. You're not supposed to. This is the next generation taking over. And, you know, I can remember the same exact words that they're saying that I hear a lot of my contemporaries saying, like, that's not music. There's no melody and there's no words.
Rock and roll started out on a corner of the streets. It's like hip hop. A few black people get together. It's devil music.
About every 10 years, everything breaks down to the lowest common denominator. And then it builds back up to the same old shit. But the only thing that survives is rock and roll.
You're talking about music that was bred from Africa to the black church and over the gospel, which turned into blues and jazz and country music. And it cross-pollinates, and that's the way it ought to be. That's how it started.
It's only now, later on, that I look back and say, hey, you know, I didn't start listening to music in 1956. I was listening to it in 1946 without even me knowing. You know, I was listening to stuff my mum, whatever she wanted to hear, I had to hear. And so I was brought up on a lot of very good jazz and a lot of good vocalists and a lot of good guitar players. And if you turn out to be a musician, anything you've ever heard comes out in what you play. You only need a few geniuses and great musicians here and there, that's enough to play it. The real beauty and art of music is listening to it.
I don't
don't want you wash my clothes. I don't want you keep my home. Wanna make love to you, baby. Love to you, baby. Love to you, baby. Love to you, God. Tell by the way that you switch out song. See by the way that you play that song. I don't know by the way that you treat your man. I can love you, baby, till the fighting. I don't want you.
In a way, Muddy Waters was the focus. Perhaps of all the good things about that Chicago blues era. He had a great voice, he was an interesting guitar player, he used to play harmonica, had a wonderful band. He was a big influence for me. I mean, even before the Rolling Stones existed. Got my mojo working, but just don't.
A great deal to me, and his music still does me, probably more than anybody else's. I don't know why. It was the first, really, that got to me, and it still is the most important music in my life today, is the music of Muddy Waters.
Everything that I've heard in my life is rooted in the blues, except Johann Sebastian Bach.
I mean, I'm a big blues fan. I'm more of a blues fan than a jazz fan. You know, a lot of people, I say, well, you must be in the jazz. No, that's somebody like Gangsta, Tribe Called Quest, they're into the jazz feel. But me, I'm like, it's almost like if I was brought up in Memphis.
Well, I grew up on the south side of Chicago, and the blues, naturally, was a huge part of my life. The blues and jazz were both, if it hadn't have been for black Americans, we would be doing the minuet and dancing on our tippy toes.
I have vivid memories of my uncle, my mother's brother, and my grandmother's brother, who's my great uncle, humming and singing in the fields if we were picking cotton, trying to get that 100 pounds before you went to the weigh-in scales. They were just make-up songs about, I'm so tired, I'll be so glad when the sun goes down. And when I get home, I just want to lay down my head and sleep until tomorrow.
John Westbrook was an old black man who lived across the field from me. And he worked in the cotton field, which, by the way, is the hardest work in the world. One day in the cotton field, he said, child, I want you to take your little fingers and do this. I said, Uncle John, do that again. He said,
cotton, I hated it. I hated picking cotton and chopping. It was so, the sun was so hot. I dreaded those times. That's the only thing that made me change my life. I knew that I couldn't do that. That was something that I, as a child, knew the beginning of dislike and hate and cannot do and don't want to do and will not do.
Country music is gospel. Country music is just, it's the soul of the country. You know, let's go back to that word soul. It's the soul of country music. When you listen to country music, you listen to the stories. You listen to the actual hurt, the real pain.
I wanted to be the first singing black cowboy, you know? This man influenced me. I never thought about singing, never thought I could sing until I heard Back in the Saddle Again, Peace in the Valley and all those songs. That's why I like country music today. This is my influence. This is the beginning of Hank Ballard's singing career. Gene Autry, ladies and gentlemen, I love this man. I treasure this photo. Take it everywhere I go, Gene!
Both Keith and I like country music a lot. I mean, it's the same kind of musical form as blues. I used to like George Jones, Johnny Cash, Hank Snow, Hank Williams.
I got very interested in Hank Williams because I saw him when I was very young at the Opry, at the Friday Night Frolics, actually, the first time I saw him. And I just thought, I mean, the way he approached his singing and the rhythms and stuff that he did astounded me. And he was not like anything else that was going on at the time.
I remember when I was 18 or something, I had one Hank Williams record, and I liked it, but it didn't really hit me until I was probably, you know, 26 or 27. And then I got into everything that he did.
How's about cooking something up me?
The country guys bred guys like Buddy Holly. Buddy Holly was a little bit more of a little sweeter kind of music. It was the country ballad with a rock and roll bass.
Buddy Holly had a fantastic effect upon people because he had a great guitar technique and the songs were good. I remember learning to play Ravon, the piano bit in the middle. Dun, 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 dun. And if you could play it, you felt it was great. Because it's accessible. If you can play it, it means that you're in tune with them.
Talk about gospel. Gospel is the truth, and country and western has always been the truth. But just because people speak the brogue or the accent is a little different, city folk made fun of that.
It's like a fever. You catch the fever, and it's like a gospel experience, you know. And you go into a church with black people, you know, and they whip up this choir and stuff, feeling, you know, and people in the audience are right with it, you know. And it's just gospel, you know what I mean?
You let loose. The piano was talking, the drums was walking. Oh, everybody was gone. You know, people shouting all over the place. And if you didn't understand what it was, you thought you was in a rock and roll concert. That's the way black gospel was when I was a boy.
Oh, you better run, better run, better run.
Church, the sanctified church. I'm so glad Jesus lived in me, singing glory, hallelujah, glory, hallelujah, glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me, Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me, Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me. You know what I mean? Satan had me bound, Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah, Jesus lifted me. And then they had that, you know, that holler, you know, woo, and I love that. Woo, they were just screaming. I said, oh, my Lord. It just, it made my big toe shoot up in my boot.
So music out of the church has always been my influence. And even now, I still say that there's such a fine line between gospel and R&B. There are many songs that came out of the church and ended up in the nightclub. Black Mama, She's Your Daughter Me.
Hear Ruth Brown sing, you know there's some gospel there. So it involves, you know, automatically, and you can hear it, you can feel it. That's what made the character Rhythm and Blues so popular, because people who had that spiritual feeling in background knew that there was something there that drew you to that music, that just made you want to dance, that made you want to move.
You know, R&B was a huge part of it. But then you start mixing in the country, you know, the best of the country, the sort of really swinging country. And gospel, can't forget gospel. And to some extent, jazz, I think.
Lionel Hampton and Louis Jordan were probably the first rock and roll bands that were really conscious of what we call the big beat. And it's ironic because these were both bands that had their roots steeped in jazz. And Louis Jordan was a monster, you know, and all during World War II. You know, when he did Caledonia and Beware and Suffolk, West Virginia, Choo 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 Boogie. He did Shuffle Boogie and everything else that was happening with backbeats and everything else that were all the elements of rock and roll.
I think he was really one of the first crossover artist. Louis Jordan had a great white following.
Walking with my baby, she got great big feet. She long, lean, and lanky, and ain't had nothing to eat, but she's my baby, and I love her just the same. Crazy about that woman, cause Caledonia is her name. Caledonia! Caledonia! What makes your big head so hot? I love you just the same. I'll always love you, baby, cause Caledonia is your name.
Louis Jordan was not only the first rock and roller, he was the first rapper. You gotta dig some of those old Louis Jordan records.
You know, my mama told me, she said, son, keep away from Caledonia. She ain't no good, son. She's bad for your morale. She'll have you doing things that ain't right, son. But see, mama didn't know I was in love with Caledonia. So I'm going down to Caledonia's house and ask her just one more time. Caledonia! Caledonia! Or what makes your big head so hot?
In the mid-40s and early 50s, so four major record companies, was RCA Victor, Columbia Records, Capitol Records, and Decca Records. They were all very tightly controlling what you heard, and that was the blandness. There was a thirst for different kinds of niche music, basically what they call race music, rhythm and blues.
It was controlled by a handful, and all of a sudden, they built this interconnected network of independent distributors, and you and I could make records in our garage, ship them out of our trunk, and become multimillionaires overnight. And that was the fun period. It was full of imaginative entrepreneurs who became very wealthy.
Now you had the big corporate types at RCA and Columbia and so forth who were playing the game according to Hoyle. Well, these guys were not going to play the game according to Hoyle because it was their money on the line. Their survival depended on getting their records played and sold. So they started paying off disc jockeys. They started off cutting deals with record stores. You buy one, you get one free. They just kicked the hell out of the major labels. People like the Chess Brothers started Chess Records. Lou Chud started Imperial Records. And Nathan started King Records. And Ahmet Erdogan and Jerry Wexler started Atlantic Records.
Nowadays, the people have schools they can go to and study all this music. But in those days, we had records. And, you know, all over the world, people used to collect those records. I mean, the people that we work with on Atlantic Records, for example, were from Turkey. And they came here with a knowledge already of what was happening here because they were able to get these records. And in those days, those records were like gold.
Atlantic was a label run by jazz buffs and record collectors. Two of the company's executives, Ahmet and Nesawi Ertegun, were sons of the Turkish ambassador to the United States. They called their label Atlantic for the ocean they had crossed to reach America. In the 50s, they made records with some of the country's most gifted black artists.
I felt that I knew what black life was in America, and I knew what black music was in America, and I knew what black roots and what black gospel music and black blues from the Delta that went on to Chicago and the Texas blues that went on to the West Coast. I knew what they were, and I knew all about that. And I loved all of that. So in loving America, I thought I loved something more than the average American knew about.
We placed such an emphasis at Atlantic Records on bel canto, on great ability, on a Joe Turner who could have been an opera singer with that beautiful, great, big, rolling, tumbling voice of his.
Big Joe Turner was a man who cut across many lines. He was a great blues man, rhythm and blues man, rock and roll man, and a reputation in the jazz field.
With the Joe, like a Joe Turner song, like Shake, Rattle, and Roll, and a Louis Jordan song, it's rockin'. Before you know it, you're putting rockin' and rollin' together, and you're getting rockin' and rollin'. And rockin' and rollin' was a not-so-subtle way of talking about having a good time, dancing, and sometimes it meant sex.
Like a one-eyed cat, peeping in a thief's door. Like a one-eyed cat, peeping in a thief's door. I can look at you, baby, there you ain't no child no more. Well, over the hill, way down underneath. Well, over the hill, way down underneath. You make me roll my eyes, baby, baby, grit my teeth.
Thanks to Big Joe Turner, Atlantic was present in the creation of rock and roll. But the label's presiding genius was the blind singer and pianist Ray Charles, who blended jazz, gospel, and blues into an urbane yet earthy new style of black popular music.
Ray Charles' his playing is so superb, and he's just so good. So I can't pin him down to just saying this is church or this. Ray does it all. Ray Charles is without a doubt, as they say, a genius. To me, he is even more so.
Ray and I became good friends, and we thought he was something from Mars because, you know, we were 14 years old, and we were still living at home, and Ray had his own apartment. He had three suits, and he had these older girlfriends, you know. I mean, he was unbelievable. He'd take off, he'd have record players, the electric record players, and Ray would take them apart, and glass tubes and record players, and he knew how to take everything apart and fix it and everything else.
I met him in Austin, Texas, And I was supposed to be just the traveling vocalist and work with his band. And I'll never forget the first day when I showed up for rehearsals and I raised sand. I said to my road manager, how is he going to play for me? He's blind, you know, because I had all these charts. And I remember he said to me, don't worry about it. And the first night we worked together, Austin, Texas, he played everything that I had done like he had been in a recording session.
At about 17, he went down to California. And when he came back, he was so different. You know, it was just like another person, you know. He was singing different music, you know, and he was singing the gospel thing then. It was like he'd found this light.
I say it's all right. That's because I got a woman way over town.
Wanted the band to make a record as good as Ray Charles. He always made the best records as far as I was concerned. Had the best band in town at the same time. Anything to do with Ray Charles was all right.
I remember the first time I heard Ray Charles sing. He was saying, I got a woman way over town. She's good to me. And my mama said, now that's a shame. That man has taken that gospel song and turned it into the blues. Because the original lyric was, there's a man going round taking names. And then when she found out he was blind, oh, she really went off. Oh, my God, this was sacrilegious.
In Chicago, yet a different style of black music evolved. In search of work, bluesmen throughout the 1940s had journeyed north. In the noisy nightclubs and juke joints of Chicago's South Side, the harmonica players and guitarists plugged in and produced an electrifying new brand of blues.
Dad would take me down to Maxwell Street, which was kind of like, I guess, Portobello Road in London or something, but it'd be street musicians and just wonderful sounds and everything, you know. Living in Chicago was quite a rich environment.
Chicago is also a place that you learn to play many different types of music because you have jazz clubs, blues clubs, all the different types of music are very popular there. And I got a job at Chess Records. I was a studio musician, studio drummer. Well, working at Chess was a very interesting time in my life. I mean, anything could happen. I remember Bo Diddley because I used to run into him in the studio all the time.
Leonard Chess loved the blues. Anytime they had a session, they would call Bo Diddley in, and Bo Diddley was like an A&R man. Because he lived in Chicago, Leonard Chess could not A&R session. They ran the technical side. But Bo Diddley was really the man who set down that pattern.
Diddley's one of my favorite guitar players. He only plays one chord, but I can listen to that for days. It's just so cool.
Bo Diddley, but Bo Diddley. I remember listening to it in one of those
earphones. A friend of mine in high school said, have you heard Bo? And I go, diddly. I says, no. And it changed me. The beat and the rhythms and the things, it haunted me. And that, so I tuned my guitar to G and everything because of that.
Little Richard, Jerry Lee Lewis, Bo Diddley, Fats Domino. You know, this is like the air we breathe. You know, this is our, you know, as far as I'm concerned, it's our classical music.
Fats Domino, of course. Inspired me because he can make three chords sound so good, you know, instead of like plonk, plonk, plonk. He did it in a nice picturesque way as to bring out the beauty of just three chords, like almost like a blues singer, but at the same time, an R&B singer.
Boy, when I heard that guy doing that, Fats and all his trills that he would do, he was absolutely brilliant. All guitar players were influenced by Chuck Berry.
Chuck Berry is one of the founders of what came out of rhythm and blues and became known as rock and roll.
How big an influence? I don't know, but the first time I ever went to go sing a Chuck Berry song, I had never tried to sing one. And I realized that I knew all the words and I could play it without even having ever tried to play it before.
I knew when I first heard Maybelline, I said, look out, here is a black man that likes country music.
Without a doubt, the greatest poet in rock and roll would be Chuck Berry.
I always felt that Chuck Berry was the poet laureate of America, you know.
He probably was the best lyric writer I was ever around. And he was awesome on the stage as well. I mean, Chuck Berry was an act you didn't want to try to follow. When he got out and did his duck walk with that out-of-tune guitar, which most of the time it was, but nobody cared, the crowd was making more noise than his guitar was.
Let's go back to who was the king of rock and roll. You know, you've often heard Little Richard come on television and say, I was the king of rock and roll. I agree. I also would like to add Chuck Berry with it. But Little Richard was the star in that era with rock and roll.
Little Richard was far and away the most flamboyant of the performers. We just thought it was so against the rules that Little Richard would jump on the piano and dance wearing his cape and that wonderful pencil mustache and be so out there. And we all went crazy. I danced then. We'd get up in the balcony and jump around, and the balcony would shake, and you'd feel, this balcony's gonna crash. But it's rock and roll, and we're out there gambling.
Go, man, go. I got a gal that I love, so I'm ready. Going to the corner, pick up my sweetie pie. She's my rock and roll baby. She's the apple of my eye. I'm ready, 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 I'm ready. Ready, 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 I'm ready. Ready, 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 I'm ready, ready, ready to rock and roll. All the flat top cats and all the dungaree dogs. I headed for the them to the soccer ball.
Little Richard was black rock and roll. I mean, we understand that Little Richard was Tutti Frutti, Good Golly Miss Molly. He was all those things that everybody else wanted to be. He was our Elvis Presley.
I think of Little Richard washing dishes in the bus station in Macon, Georgia. And he knows that he's going to make it. And he made it out of that kitchen and into the history books. That is great. His records are great. They still sound great. They always will.
Black people, they drew out of their community this powerful, emotional, majestic thing called black gospel music and jazz and blues. And all those elements combined played a part in forming rhythm and blues. And later, as the whites were attracted to it, it began to be known as rock and roll.
Rock and roll is a misnomer. There's no such music as rock and roll. Rock and roll was something that just out of necessity was termed rock and roll. There was a man by the name of Alan Freed who started playing rhythm and blues music after the classical music station went off the air in Cleveland, Ohio.
Hi, everybody. How y'all? This is yours truly, Alan Freed, welcoming you to the Big Beat once again on radio, every night at 10.
And he called the show the Moondog Show. And then he came to New York, and there was an old beggar, a panhandler, in this town by the name of the Moondog. And so Alan Freed couldn't call his show the Moondog Show anymore because the old panhandler sued him about the name. And so in the hurry to come up with a name, bottom line was he decided that he was going to call it the Rock and Roll Show.
Oh, I think that Alan Freed is important in the history of rock and roll. And I think I understand maybe a little bit why the other faction that doesn't want to acknowledge that wants to discard him. It's hard to allow a disc jockey to walk off with that mantle of importance. He didn't write anything, he didn't sing anything, he didn't arrange anything. He got on the air and he played some records.
When you're on in New York at night in the winter, there's mystery, there's romance, there's something, there's danger in the air. And that's what Alan Freed projected. Now, Alan claims he started rock and roll. Alan did not start rock and roll, but he was the disc jockey. He coined the phrase.
It was real odd because, you know, we were listening to rhythm and blues, and we knew the original artists. I mean, Fats Domino and Little Richard and all that, you know, Rip It Up, and then the white artists would cover it, and it was, I mean, we didn't know each other at the time, but it was really frustrating to know the real record and then hear, you know, I mean, God love Pat Boone. I mean, anybody can have a hit record doing, you know, God bless them. But it just was real, real weird that went on.
There was, at that time, an absolute wall, an impenetrable wall between pop and R&B. There were R&B stations, there were R&B artists, there was R&B music, but it was not going to get played in its original form on pop stations. It was just too ragged and too, in some cases it was a little suggestive or more, sometimes even explicit.
Now the Pat Boone, he was a white guy that then took my music and made my hit, and this was my chance to be a big star, and he shortcutting me and going to outsell me, which he did with my song that I wrote. You understand me? But by him singing it, he really made it bigger and made me bigger. But at the time, I didn't feel that way.
Tutti Frutti, oh Rudy. 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 Oh, bop, bop, a loom, bop, 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 bop. I got a gal, her name's Daisy. Crazy, I got a gal, her name's Daisy. Oh, she's crazy, she's a beauty.
cookie. Yes, sirree. Bert and Little Susie is the gal for me. Tootie Fruity, all Fruity. 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 Oh, my Bible, loom up a lot, bam, boom.
Yeah, name Sue. She knows just what to do. I've got a girl named Sue. She knows just what to do. She rocks to the east, she rocks to the west, but she's the gal that I love best. Tootie Fruity, oh Rudy. 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 Oh, bop, bop, loo, bop, bop, bamboo.
Rock and roll is the greatest music that's ever been. Ever will be. Whether it was taken from gospel roots, or whether it was taken from rhythm and blues roots, or black roots, or red roots, or blue roots, or whatever roots, rock and roll is rock and roll.
Bill Haley started as Bill Haley and the Saddlemen, a country band in Chester, Pennsylvania. He was one of the creators of rockabilly. And it goes way back to 54, 53 on Essex Records. All of those wonderful precursors of rock and roll. Kids loved it.
Bill Haley was a country to the bone. He was really a country guy who had the saxophone and had that great record. He had many, but Rock Around the Clock was a pattern setter, let's face it.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, rock. 9, 10, 11 o'clock, 12 o'clock, rock, we're going to rock. Around the clock tonight, put your glad rags on. Join me, hon, we'll have some fun. When the clock strikes one, we're going to rock. Around the clock tonight, we're going to rock, rock, rock. No broad daylight, going to rock, going to rock. Around the clock tonight. When the clock strikes 2, 3, and 4, if the band goes down, we'll yell for more. We're going to rock around the clock tonight. We're going to rock, rock, rock. No broad daylight, going to rock, going to rock. Around the clock tonight.
I think one of the attractions of Bill Haley was that he was, I mean, apart from the great music and the new style of energy, was that he seemed to be one of us. He seemed to be a normal guy. I mean, even though he had this funny curl and stuff and he was a little overweight maybe. I specifically remember seeing Blackbird Jungle and going down the stairs in the cinema in Manchester where I lived and seeing all the Teddy Boys tearing up seats in the cinema and seeing people turn fire hoses on them. I mean, it was quite wild. I think he was more popular in England than he was here. I mean, he was a god in England. I didn't see that kind of energy until later when the Beatles first hit. There was something about Bill Haley that was very close to our hearts and yet very unattainable. I have in my wallet, there's my ticket for the Bill Haley show in 1958 at the Palace Theatre in Manchester that changed my life.
So when Elvis Presley came on the scene, the only thing I can say is that he did it right. He did it good, you know. And again, where Elvis was concerned, there was no color line because everybody liked his music. And Elvis Presley was what they were looking for to get that music not necessarily accepted because it had already been accepted, but permissible for the white kids to listen to and openly.
People are amazed at Elvis, at his influence. I'm not. And honey, it didn't come just from his music. It came from what he could say and just a little innuendos of his voice. He could do things that had to be something other than carnal. It had to be a spiritual communication.
I listened to it, and I listened to where he was coming from when he was singing it, and where the band were coming from, and the way that they were playing and swinging, and the way Presley was taking all that white, poor boy, Tupelo, Mississippi guy, and all the radio he'd heard, Arthur Crudup, all the kind of ink spots, all that stuff is in his voice. Elvis was so crucial.
I remember being writing arrangements for Tommy Dorsey on the Saturday Night Bandstand, which is a replacement for Jackie Gleason. And one night, This little kid came from Memphis and sang on the show. The band was pissed off, you know, and they couldn't play with each other or get into it at all. And Tommy and Jimmy Dorsey had the band. I remember Sam Phillips said, we'll send for the band from Memphis. And they came back up, and Elvis played on that show. And Tommy was upset. He said, oh, man, this dude, he'll be out of here tomorrow, you know. And 2 days later, they got 8,000 letters. And it was over. And I think 3 or 4 weeks later, he played on the Sullivan Show. And Elvis was on that show, the Saturday Night Bandstand, until it closed, you know.
Well, since my baby left me, well, I found a new place to dwell. Well, it's down at the end of Lonely Street, Heartbreak Hotel, where I'll be. He's a lonely baby. Well, I'm so lonely. Well, I'm so lonely. I could die.
See, in white society, movement of the butt, shaking the leg, all that was considered obscene for white folks. Now, here's this white boy. And they're grinding, rolling his belly and shaking that notorious leg. I hadn't even seen the black dudes doing it. Elvis had his own. He had some movements I hadn't ever witnessed.
I one time went to a country music show at Baton Rouge High School, and there was a guy in this pink suit with a guitar player and a bass player, and it was Elvis singing Blue Moon of Kentucky. And I remember standing, going with my friend back behind the auditorium after the show, and standing next to this guy going, wow, this guy is really cool.
If your baby leaves you, you got a tale to tell. Just take a walk down Lonely Street to Heartbreak Hotel. Where you will be, you'll be so lonely. Where you'll be lonely, you'll be so lonely. You could die.
Oh, Elvis. He was rock and roll. That's rock and roll, you know. Rock and roll, really, I can get down to about 6-7 people, you know. But he is above it all, you know. He was rock and roll.
Just let me hear some of that rock and roll music. Any old way you choose it. It's got a backbeat, you can't lose it. Any I have no kick against modern jazz, unless they try to play it too darn fast and change the beauty of the melody until it sounds just like a symphony. That's why I go for that rock and roll music. Any old way you choose it, it's got a backbeat, you can't lose it. Any old time you use it, it's gotta be rock and roll music. The mood to dig a mambo. It's way too early for the Congo. So keep a rocking that piano, so I can hear some of that rock and roll music. Any old way you choose it, it's got a backbeat, you can't lose it. Any old time you use it, it's gotta be rock and roll music. If you want.